Hi everyone, I'm Tom, and today I would like to show you PrintToPeer in a guide, review, show and tell kind of way. So you probably know about Octoprint and how it makes your 3D printer accessible through your network and without the need for a dedicated computer to babysit the entire process. And that's pretty much what PrintToPeer does as well, but it is going a step further and also does all the slicing for you in the cloud. Now, of course, I am going to compare it a lot to Octoprint because that's the most popular alternative to PrintToPeer right now, but I'm also going to compare it to BotQ, and that's something that you might not have heard of yet. Basically, that was the first software that had the entire idea of untethering a 3D printer from a computer, but while it's geared more towards huge bot farms like the one that Lootsbot runs, PrintToPeer still feels like it's at least very heavily inspired by the way BotQ does things. But more on that later. Now, the first thing I want to show you about PrintToPeer is the setup process, because that's already something that stands out. Of course, since this is based around the Raspberry Pi, you will need one of those, and also the usual set of accessories like a power supply, USB cable, SD card, and an Ethernet cable or a Wi-Fi USB stick. For the entire process, PrintToPeer will take you by the hand and tell you step by step what you need to do. Now, for using wired LAN, aka Ethernet, it is extremely simple to set up. Transfer the image to your SD card, plug everything in, click through the wizard on PrintToPeer's site, and your browser will then automatically detect and configure your Raspberry Pi with the PrintToPeer client. And while it's not so obviously documented, you can also use Wi-Fi. For that, PrintToPeer will set up an access point on your Raspberry Pi, which you can then connect to with your computer and then tell the Raspberry Pi which wireless network it should in turn use. And that's a really smart way of handling things. Both Octoprint and BotQ are still a bit tedious to set up for exactly this reason. At least for configuring Wi-Fi, you still need to jump through a couple of extra hoops to get things to work, because it is essentially a chicken and egg problem. Now, like I said, PrintToPeer's solution is really elegant when it works, but when it does not, there really is not much you can do about it. While I did get it to work on the first try through Ethernet, it took me about 15 tries for Wi-Fi. If you have an absolute default setup, well, then things are probably going to go smoothly. But here's some things that I should have checked beforehand. 1. Use a really good power supply, preferably a phone or tablet charger and not a computer's USB port. And preferably also use a Raspberry Pi Plus, since those have a slightly better power design. 2. Make sure you have Bonjour installed if you're on Windows, and on the same token, don't use Google DNS in your computer's network settings, because that's going to throw the discovery process way off. And 3. Connect your 3D printer to the Raspberry Pi at this point. I'm not sure if that's actually required, but the times where I did get it to work, I always had some printer plugged into the Raspberry Pi. So yeah, when things work, they are magical. But when they don't, there's not much you can do about it other than guessing. Sure, you can add a bit of manualness to your setup process or use SSH to connect to the Raspberry Pi even before it's completely set up, but then what? By the way, the username and password for SSH are, you guessed it, Pi and Raspberry, which is the exact same on pretty much any Raspberry Pi setup. They should really change those. Moving on, once the Raspberry Pi has established a connection to PrintToPeer servers, you get to name that client and set up a printer for it. And this is where one of the core principles of PrintToPeer shine through, and that's reusable profiles. Because I have set up my Big Mandel 90 before, I can simply pick that printer type again. Or, of course, you can punch in your own settings. In my case, I simply copy-pasted them from my slicer. Next up, we get to initialize the printer. And I was seriously scared of that step, because it doesn't tell you anywhere what exactly it's going to initialize. Maybe it's going to home my printer right past the print bed and shove the nozzle into the bed's base. Maybe it's going to try a test print and make a huge mess. I don't know, but really, all it does is connect to the printer. And staying with the theme of profiles, you can create even more of them when it comes to print settings and filament types, which I think is an awesome way to go about it. So if you have two printers and a stash of filament, you simply create a profile for each roll once, and you can then use them for any printer. As far as the slicing profiles go, again, I simply copy-pasted most of it from my known good slicer configuration, and that worked pretty well. But I noticed that there were a couple of settings missing. For example, it always assumes that you want a single skirt loop printed before your part, and that's what most people use, but it limits your usable print space, and in my case, I don't really need it anyways because I use some custom start G-code to prime my hardened before printing anyways. Also missing is the brim setting, which is an absolute deal breaker for me as I mostly print ABS, and many parts simply cannot be printed without a brim or they will peel off of the bed in the most unfortunate moment. Another setting that's not there is the top and bottom solid layer setting. You can only set the number of perimeters for each layer. Some other settings that Slick3R would have in the print settings, like speed and such, can be configured in the printer settings instead, and it does make sense to have them there. Speaking of slices, with the same settings, you can use either Slick3R or the Cura engine, falsely called Cura here, to slice your parts, but that is a per printer setting, so it's not really trivial to switch between them. Over at the Filament Profiles, there is one set of settings that's really missing, and that's the option of setting minimum layer times and cooling settings, because there really isn't one solution that fits all sizes. Especially ABS and PLA need to be treated differently, but PrintToPeer has absolutely no option of, for example, adjusting the fan speed or even turning it off for different filament types. And that might also be somewhat of a deal breaker for you. Now, the entire interface of PrintToPeer can be somewhat confusing at first, because there are quite a few menus and subpages where you'll find all the different things you can do with PrintToPeer. But once you figure it out, you kind of get a feeling for where you need to click to get where you want to go. The entire interface is also a so-called responsive design, which means that you get the same design and functionality across all your devices, even tablets, phones, and smartwatches. Which is something that especially Octoprint is currently still having quite some trouble with, since it doesn't really offer a mobile interface. In PrintToPeer, the entire interface is very much centered around getting print jobs done, which is perfect if you have a printer that can simply work on one job after another without flinching. To start the print, you can simply upload an STL file, choose a printing profile, and off it goes. Now, this is that simple, but it also lacks some of the very basic functionality that a slicer should have, particularly rotating and moving parts. You get a nice fancy 3D preview, but that's view only, there's nothing you can interact with here. So, even though PrintToPeer advertises with being so simple to use, you will still find yourself working on files with Netfab, even if it's only to orient them properly for printing. This dialog is also missing all functionality like printing multiple copies of the same thing, creating build plates, and so on. As the print starts, you get a minimum amount of feedback, being temperatures of the hardened and bed, as well as what the printer is doing at the moment. There is no live time estimate or any way of influencing the print other than canceling it. Other hosts, including Octoprint, allow you to at least send G-code commands, for example, to nudge the print parameters in the right direction. Once the print is finished, the printer will go into a blocked mode where it just does nothing until you confirm that the print bed is clear and the printer is ready for the next print. If you have started multiple print jobs, the printer will then automatically download the next one and get back to printing. Now, if you want your printer to do something other than processing job after job, you can put it into maintenance mode where you get full manual control over the entire machine. This is basically the same control panel as in any other host, but it looks a bit nicer. There's also the aforementioned console, which you can use for more advanced stuff or manual control. For example, I turn my power supply on and off with M80 and M81. But since that console only communicates one way, it is rather useless for many things, since you don't see what the printer replies to your commands. Maintenance mode is also where you can choose a different filament for your printer. But that might be a bit counterintuitive, as many new printers have an LCD screen where you can very easily load and unload filament with the push of a button. But you then still need to put the printer into maintenance mode in PrintToPeer, select a different filament, and exit maintenance mode again. Now, I guess that covers what you can do with PrintToPeer, but that's all pretty much basic functionality. What really stands out is the way it does it. While Octoprint very heavily relies on the fact that your printer and the device you're controlling it with are on the same network, PrintToPeer instead offloads everything into the cloud, or simply speaking, their web interface. Everything you want your printer to do first passes through PrintToPeer servers, be it print jobs or simple one-line commands. And that means that first of all, the entire network configuration thing gets a bit easier. But it also means that you can remotely control your printer and start jobs from anywhere in the world where you have an internet connection. Setting up Octoprint for the same level of comfort is pretty tedious, having to deal with port forwarding, dynamic IPs, TLS encryption, and so on. PrintToPeer takes all of that out of your hands and does it for you, which is pretty nice, honestly. But there is a price you pay in flexibility and functionality, especially with the built-in slices, and there's currently no way around them. You can't even upload a G-code file that you slice yourself. Yet. Now, PrintToPeer was initially funded through Indiegogo, hitting their stretch goal where the entire server codebase will be released under an open source license. This has yet to happen, but the code is currently being prepared for release. While Octoprint now has Gino Heuske as a full-time developer sponsored by BQ, BotQ being more of a collaborative side project, PrintToPeer actually is a real company that kind of needs to survive on something. In their case, that is going to be printer-specific and branded implementations of the PrintToPeer service. And actually, that is an excellent fit for what they provide, with everything already being as easy to use as it is right now. For the foreseeable future, PrintToPeer will not have ads and stay free to use, which I think is awesome, and while I personally will stick to Octoprint for now because it is still the mightier and more flexible platform, PrintToPeer really has quite some potential for being the next big thing. Maybe adding an advanced mode with as much functionality as possible would win me over. Also, some features were promised in the crowdfunding campaign that aren't quite there yet, like webcam support with an automatic detection of failed prints, or currently webcam support at all, additional user accounts for shared printers, which would be awesome, and support for a wider range of printers, including pre-made profiles for the most popular ones, with guides doing some basics on them, like adjusting the print bed or swapping filament. Anyways, if you want to try out or simply learn more about PrintToPeer, there are some links to their site and to the finished Indiegogo campaign in this video's description. As always, thank you for watching. Please like, share, subscribe if you enjoy what I'm doing, and I'll see you next week.